Hello friends, I am Prashant Vishwanath Dhanshetti, Assistant Professor, Department of Civil Engineering from Walchand Institute of Technology, Solapur. Today I am here to explain you about the expression for the crippling load when both ends of the column are fixed using Euler's column theory. The learning outcome of today's lecture is that students will be able to derive the crippling load when both ends of the columns are fixed. So the compression member, it is a member of a structure which is subjected to axial compressive load. Column is the structure which is vertical and both its ends are fixed rigidly while subjected to axial compressive load. Now the failure of column may occur. The column failure may occur by direct compressive stress. So this case will be majorly found in case of short column, where length upon least lateral dimension is lesser than 12. So it fails by crushing. And whereas long column, it fails by buckling. If the length upon least lateral dimension is greater than 12, it is called as long column, and it will fail due to buckling stresses. That is sigma b is equals to load into eccentricity divided by z. So in between the column, long and short, they may fail by combined effect of direct compression and buckling stress. Sign convention. A moment which will bend the column with its convexity towards the initial position of the column is taken as positive, whereas the column or the moment which will bend the column with its concavity towards the initial center line is taken as negative. Now, what is column and strut? So explain the difference between column and strut. Here pause the video and try to write answer on a paper. So as we know that column is a compression member which is vertical and both its ends are fixed rigidly while subjected to axial compressive load. Now what is strut? So strut is also a compression member but is not vertical, and one or both of its ends are hinged or pinned while subjected to compressive load. Now to find the crippling load when both ends of the column are fixed, so we will consider a column of AB having length L with uniform cross sectional area A, which are fixed at end A and B. And a crippling load P is applied to the column which just buckles the column. So due to that buckling, the curvature of the column will be A, C and B. So as the both ends are fixed, it will be subjected to fixed end moment, that is M0 at end A and B. So this will be acting anticlockwise and here it will be acting clockwise moment. Now we will consider a section at a distance of x from A which is having a deflection or y at this point. So the moment due at this point due to the applied crippling load and moment is, so m0. m0 is the moment due to fixity. So this is clockwise, and minus p into y. So this crippling load p into this distance y, it is acting anticlockwise, so I am giving here a negative sign. So again we can have the moment as EI d2y by dx square. So now equating this both the moment, we get EI d2y by dx square is equals to m0 minus p into y. So now I will take this negative term on the left hand side, so I will get EI d2y by dx square plus p into y is equals to m0. So now dividing this whole term by EI, I will get d2y by dx square plus p upon EI into y is equals to m0 upon EI. So now this equation can be written as d2y by dx square plus alpha square into y is equals to m0 upon EI, where alpha square is p upon EI, or alpha is equals to under root p by EI. So now the solution of this equation is y is equals to c1 cos alpha x plus c2 sin alpha x plus m0 upon EI into alpha square. Now putting the value of alpha in this, we will get y is equals to c1 cos into bracket x under root p upon ei, where alpha is equals to p upon under root p upon ei, plus c2 sin x under root p upon ei plus m0 upon ei into p by ei. Now this ei will get cancelled. So we will get this equation, that is y is equals to c1 cos x under root pi plus c2 sin into bracket x under root p upon ei plus m0 upon p. So this will be your equation 1. Now depending upon the end condition, so we know that as end A is fixed at x is equals to 0, so deflection at this point is 0 and also the slope, that is dy by dx, is also 0. Similarly, when x is equals to L at point B, x is equals to L, y is equals to 0 and dy by dx is also 0. So now substituting the value, that is x is equals to 0, y is equals to 0 in equation 1. So I get y is equals to 0 c1 cos, now x term is 0, so this whole term will become 0, it is cos 0 plus c2 sin, and this term will become 0 sin 0 plus m0 by p. So cos 0 is having value 1 and sin 0 is having value 0. So putting that, I will get 0 is equals to c1 plus m0 by p. Therefore, c1 is equals to minus m0 by p. This will be equation 2. So now again, for the slope, I want dy by dx. So this equation 1, differentiating, I will get dy by dx is equals to c1 minus sin x under root p upon ei into under root p by ei plus c2 sin x under root p upon ei into under root p upon ei plus derivative of this constant is 0. So what I will get is dy by dx is equals to minus c1 sin into bracket x under root p upon ei into under root p by ei plus c2 cos into bracket x under root p by ei bracket close into under root p by ei. Now substituting the value, now we know that x is at x is equals to 0, dy by dx is also 0. So putting this in above equation, what I will get is 0 is equals to minus, so now this sin 0 is 0, so I am putting here 0, and cos of 0 is 1. So 0 is equals to minus c1 plus c2 into 1 under root p upon ei. So this term, as it is multiplying by 0, it will become 0. So I will get 0 is equals to c2 under root p by ei. Now if we see this equation, so the left hand side is 0. So when it will be 0? When either c2 value should be 0 or under root p upon ei value should be 0. So but for a crippling load of p, the value of under root p upon ei cannot be 0. Therefore, naturally c2 term must be equals to 0. So putting c2 is equals to 0. Now substituting c1 is equals to minus m0 by p and c2 is equals to 0 in equation 1, we get y is equals to minus m0 by p cos into bracket x under root p upon ei plus, now 0 because c2 term is 0 here, plus m0 by p. So I will get y is equals to minus m0 by p cos into bracket x under root p by ei plus m0 by p. So this is equation number 3. Now again we know the end condition at x is equals to L, y is again 0. So now putting this value in equation number 3, so what I will get is y is equals to 0 and your x is again L. So instead of x I am putting here L, so 0 is equals to minus m0 by p cos of L under root p by ei plus m0 by p. So now this negative term I will take it on the left hand side, so I will get m0 by p into cos of under bracket L under root p by ei is equals to m0 by p. So now this m0 by p here, so I am taking on right hand side, this p will get multiplied and m0 will get divided. So putting that value, so what I will get is cos into bracket L under root P by I is equals to 1, because M0 and PP will get cancelled. So I will get 1 here. So the cos of L under root P by I is equals to 1. So when this cos value will be 1, so for cos 0 you will be having value 1, or cos 2 pi you will be having 1, cos 4 pi you will be having 1, or cos 6 pi, like this you will be having 1. So now putting this term, that is L under root P by I, it should be either equals to 0 or 2 pi, 4 pi, 6 pi. Now taking the least practical value, that is 2 pi. So equating it, L into under root P by I is equals to 2 pi. Now squaring both the sides, what I will get is L square into P upon I is equals to 4 pi square. So from this I will get P is equals to 4 pi square I upon L square. So now this is the crippling load when both ends of the columns are fixed. Now what will be the effective length of the column with both ends fixed? So now if you see the condition when both ends are hinged, so the crippling load is P is equals to pi square EI upon L square, whereas Euler's formula is also P is equals to pi square EI upon L effective square. So now comparing this relation, we get L effective is equals to L. Now when both ends of columns are fixed, so this P is equals to 4 pi square EI upon L square, whereas Euler's load, that is P is equals to pi square EI upon L effective square. Now comparing this, what we will get, L effective is equals to L by 2. These are my references which I have referred. Thank you. Thank you very much for watching my video.